So I was browsing your website, and on your website you talk about improving the business climate here in the state, and talking about how you want to make, you know, the business climate competitive here. So how will you make, you know, the business climate competitive?
Well, the emphasis that I placed in my first term, and I intend to continue if I get reelected, is on fiscal responsibility on the part of the state. That is, not spending more than we take in the way of revenue. And we've done a pretty good job of that for the last 2 years. I hope to do better as time goes forward. But I think developing a tax climate that is favorable to business development, that lures new business into the state, and also reducing the amount of red tape that business has to put up with in order to comply with various governmental ideas would be a good thing. So fiscal responsibility and limiting regulation to just what's absolutely necessary.
What about in like smaller communities, say like Oskaloosa, that maybe might not track economic development as much as they should, you know, maybe have some outdated numbers? You know, isn't it hard to keep the climate competitive when there isn't any current numbers?
I'm not sure exactly what you mean by that. I think Oskaloosa is as eligible for economic development as any other community in the state, frankly. I think we've got a trained workforce here. We've got some good employers, large employers here, as well as small businesses. And I think Oskaloosa is in a position to grow, frankly.
Sure. All right. Let's move on. You talk about protecting the family budget on your website as well. And you're talking about, but once again, the state budget being mismanaged. I read also on there that you say on there something about the Taxpayers' Rights Amendment and adding an amendment to our Constitution limiting the growth of state spending. And you say that would go a long way toward protecting taxpayers. I'm just wondering, you know, what is this Taxpayers' Right Amendment? I mean, what exactly does that do? Would that do?
Well, Governor Branstad and others are now getting together as a group. I think we're going to see some unity amongst the two legislative bodies, at least the Republicans in those two bodies, and the governor going forward. And one of the things they want to do is amend Iowa's Constitution to make it so that in order to raise taxes, it's going to take a two-thirds vote in each house. What this does is keep us from using the word notwithstanding every time the legislature decides to ignore the law about various fiscal matters. And I think that's also a step in the right direction.
Do you think an amendment to the Constitution is really necessary? Isn't there a way as a lawmaker that you can, you know, make this, get the same result without amending the Constitution?
Frankly, no. If we pass a law in this legislature that says, whatever, we're going to cut taxes by 20%, the next legislature can come along and say, notwithstanding the actions of the previous legislature, we're going to do something else. If it's in the Constitution, it's dramatically more difficult to do that. And that's why I think some of these matters do bear constitutional amendment.
Sure. Okay. And some might say that the TRA could cut even more funding from the schools. You know, how does that help when schools are already operating at 0% allowable growth? Doesn't that go against helping the schools out?
The schools got one time 0% allowable growth. Mm-hmm. That is not necessarily going to be the case ever again. And there are some other considerations. There's some legislation being considered that would change the manner in which we fund schools. So I think it's too early to say right now what the next legislature is going to do about school funding. But keep in mind, nobody in the legislature, I don't think, in either party, wants to underfund education. We think there might be some economies here and there. There might be some better ways of doing business. But nobody wants to seriously underfund education.
Let's move on. Talking about, you mentioned respecting voters as an issue on your website, and you say on there 2 years ago that the Iowa Supreme Court had its marriage law turned on its head. Can you tell me, what do you mean by that?
The marriage law is only the question. The issue to me is, who's the final arbiter of what is in the state's constitution? Now, the court ruled that the Constitution says X. I think that the people should have the opportunity to revise that Constitution to what they thought it said before the court ruled, if they so choose. If they choose to agree with the justices, I have no problem with that, but I think they ought to be afforded the opportunity to express their opinion.
And now, is that something that you can actually do as a state legislator? Put that action? Can you, you know, make that happen?
Well, yeah, but it's going to take a constitutional amendment. What we would have to do is amend the Constitution by passing the same legislation through both houses in two sessions, and that, even after that, all that does is get the people to vote. And then if it gets through all of those wickets, then you amend the Constitution.
Sure.
But it's a pretty lengthy, difficult process, and frankly, I think it should be.
Let's talk about some of the things that coming out of this past year's session in 2012. There were some, I think their education reform is one of the things that's definitely being talked about. And then there's the mental health reform. Talk to me a little bit about, you know, your plans for that, because there are, you know, some people here in this community that those types of services are important.
Sure. Education reform was proposed on kind of a grand scale by the governor. And with one house controlled by the Republicans and one house controlled by the Democrats, the chances of that getting through intact was nearly zero, and in fact it didn't. I think that's just one of the reasons why I'm working very hard to see to it that we get a majority in the Senate and maintain our majority in the House, because those big broad issues like that are going to be very difficult to get through a divided legislature, no matter who proposes them. The mental health reform, I don't serve on any committees that dealt with that, so I'm not probably as knowledgeable as I should be. But our understanding was that there was general agreement amongst the experts in mental health that this was a step in the right direction in terms of providing equitable funding across the state. There was a feeling that some counties were getting more money or keeping more of their money than others, and that it was important that the entire state be on a level playing field.